Thanks for joining this. My name is Venkatesh Hariharan. Most people call me Venki. My background is that I've been in the open source community since way back in 1999 when my friends and I started a nonprofit called indlinux.org with the goal of localizing Linux to Indian languages. So today, if you download and install Ubuntu or any variant of Linux, you can see that there are Indian language interfaces in about 17 languages. So that was my first initiation to Linux and open source. And I spent about 7-8 years working with Red Hat. And after that, I spent a year working with Google. And I'm now the India representative for the Open Invention Network, an organization that protects the open source community from patent litigation. Over the last month or so, I've also been advising a research project by the Civic Data Labs, which is looking at the history of the open source community in India and what can be done to take it forward. So some of the work that I'm presenting, some of the data and the findings that I present here are based on that research project. Having said that, let me quickly get into the talk. My goal with doing this talk is to see if we can encourage more cross-border collaborations with the open source community globally and the open source community in India, and see how we Indian open source community mutually beneficial relationship, because if we can get the vast amount of Indian developers participating in the global open source community, I think it's good for India as well as for the world. So having said that, let me just quickly start off. The current scenario in India is that we are an active consumer of FOSS. Some of the largest e-government projects in India are built on the open source software. For example, the Goods and Service Tax Network, which is used by almost all medium and large enterprises in India for their sales and purchase invoices, that is built on top of open source. We have about 4.36 million IT employees in India. India has also pioneered some very unique digital infrastructure in the area of identity, payments, and data sharing. And these are all built as public infrastructure, which can be leveraged by the government as well as the private sector. And these are built as horizontal infrastructure. And these speak to what Tim O'Reilly has been talking of as the government as a platform, as a set of digitized open API-based services. So Aadhaar is, of course, one of the most famous examples of this, which has enrolled 1.2 billion Indians into a foundational ID. And billions of Aadhaar authentications are done on a monthly basis. India has also built a highly interoperable payment network called the Unified Payment Interface. And basically, it's a mobile-first instantaneous payment network which enables me to send money to anyone else who's also on the UPI network. What is interesting is that globally, the challenge that policymakers face is that payment networks end up becoming duopolies. So you have a MasterCard and a Visa, you have a Alipay and WeChat in China. But here in India, because we have inserted a platform between the consumers and the end users, the Unified Payment Interface platform, you cannot create monopolies on top of it. It's much harder to create a monopoly on top of the Unified Payment Interface. And as a consumer, I have a choice of some 160 different banking apps and other apps to use as an end user. So the learnings from that are being taken into an open source project called mojaloop.io. And so we are seeing now slowly some kind of new open source projects coming in. So I think that is a unique kind of a development that's happening. The IT industry has been a huge driver of growth in India. It's been a great driver of well-paying jobs in India. So basically, we have $180 billion IT industry in 2019. Companies like Accenture and others have, IBM and others have a huge number of their employees based out of India. And the software industry contributes approximately 8% to India's GDP. We have 600 million 4G subscribers. What's also now happening is slowly new interesting contributions to the global open source community are coming in. So Julia programming language, which is used by the Federal Aviation Administration in the US and some of the largest engineering colleges in the world, et cetera. So one of the founders of the Julia programming language is based in India, and three of them are based out of the US. Open source companies are also finding greater success. So the Hasura, which is a company which works on GraphQL APIs, they raised about $36.5 million, partly based in San Francisco, partly based in Bangalore. We are also seeing many enterprise open source software programs coming up. Baggisto, ERP Next, which is started by a company based in Mumbai, deeplearning.scala, and many other projects which have been started by a company called ThoughtWorks, which is it's based in India, in Bangalore. So the contribution of code back to the global open source community is slowly picking up. Like I mentioned, you know, India does, it uses a lot of open source code, and now according to GitHub, we are now the third largest. I think we're still far behind China, and this graph does not show the US, but we are picking up in terms of our usage of open source and the activity on GitHub. When it comes to the government, there are tons and tons of, you know, policies. I think if you, as an open source evangelist, if you ask for any policy, it is there on paper. But the challenge is that implementation of policies in India is always difficult. It's that's where the weak link in India exists. But the good news, at least, is that there is a policy which says that all things being equal, if there are two different competing applications for a particular e-government use case, the government will go with the open source option. There is also a policy which says that the development of government applications should, you know, preferably be done using open source methodologies in a collaborative kind of a model. There is a policy on open APIs. There's a policy on open standards, which is important because it encourages, I mean, if you have proprietary standards like the .doc format, et cetera, it's very difficult for the open source community to then compete because these are standards which are known only to players like Microsoft. The Indian Patent Act, Section 3K of the Indian Patent Act, does not allow for software patents. It says that business methods, mathematics, computer programs per se are not patented. So it discourages the patenting of software, but MNCs have been pushing back on this policy and saying that we need to encourage greater patenting of software. And it's been a running battle for the last 10 years. I've been deeply involved with this battle, and I think it's something that the open source community in India has to be constantly vigilant about. I could stop here and take a few questions if there are any. Let me just stop here for a few minutes. And Devdutt, thanks for the kind words. Yes, it is past midnight here in Mumbai. So if there are no questions, I'll just keep running along, and what we could do is maybe take questions at the end. If we look at education, the current scenario is that we produce about 800,000 graduates from technical institutions on a yearly basis. 60% of them remain unemployed according to the All India Council for Technical Education. The problem in India has always been that our syllabus, our curriculum basically teaches products. So you will find that the syllabus actually explicitly mentions Microsoft Word, Oracle database, et cetera, et cetera, instead of specifying spreadsheet or databases. What that does is it ties the hands of the teacher, and they have to teach Microsoft Word or Oracle instead of saying that, okay, I'm teaching you databases. So, and you know, giving the choice of using maybe a OpenOffice or a MongoDB or a Enterprise DB as alternatives to Oracle in the syllabus. The other problem is that I think the students also, you know, are used to this particular model of I think Devdutt has mentioned that there's an emphasis on rote learning, and many of my friends in the industry agree with that. So you will have people who know a particular database and you know, can do the system admin and other work around that easily because they memorize the methodologies. But if you ask them to do architecture on top of that, they will not be able to because they have not understood the concepts from a basic perspective. So it's something that we'll have to really kind of rework, and it's something that we'll have to really change over a period of time. There are some very, very interesting initiatives for open source in education. The two that I've listed on this slide are from IIT Bombay. One is the FOSSE project, FOSS in Engineering Education, which is promoting Skylab as an alternative to MATLAB, open form for computational fluid dynamics, and many other open source projects. And I think this is really important because many educational institutions in India do not have the money to buy expensive packages like MATLAB. So promoting open source packages will be very, very helpful. The good thing is that the person who's driving some of these initiatives at IIT Bombay is a person who has written the textbooks for MATLAB and is now driving the use of FOSS in engineering education. There is another initiative called Spoken Tutorial, which is also being run out of IIT Bombay. And what they have done is captured a number of screencasts and to teach languages like Java, Python, et cetera, et cetera. And they've taken that and translated that to many Indian languages. And the challenge here in India is that only about, say, 10% of the population speaks the English language. Very few. So most Indians are not familiar with English or not very comfortable with English. So the spoken tutorial system has taken these screen grabs and had them translated into many Indian languages. And I was pleasantly surprised to see that some foreign languages have also started appearing on Spoken Tutorial. It's a mammoth, massive project run by an incredibly dedicated professor out of IIT Bombay. And this could also be one of India's contribution to the global open source community, because you have these screen grabs, you have these spoken videos, which can be easily translated into any language. So having seen all this, you know, the question is the glass half full or half empty? I mean, from the industry side, we see that there's a lot of consumption of software, but not enough of contribution back to the community. From the education side, we see the emphasis on rote learning, but not enough emphasis on understanding the concepts, not a great understanding of the FOSS ecosystem, the principles of the free software movement, the open source movement, etc. So I'm someone who likes to not worry too much about whether the glass is half empty or half full. I prefer to see how we can, actually solve the problems rather than worry too much about the past. So if you want to change the situation in India, I would argue that, that basically getting Indian developers to start contributing to the global open source community will be a huge game changer for the global open source community also, because we have so many developers. I think over the next 10 years, if we put together a systematic plan of action, we can, start orienting the students, catching them young, grounding them in the values of the free and open source software community. And I think, if you take the life cycle of a software developer from the college into business houses, etc., I think we can orchestrate that journey in such a way that we can, generate greater and greater output and greater interesting projects coming out of India. I think Julia and others are great examples. The other challenge that I see in India is that, we've had people who come into the community. I spent about 7-8 years in the open source community before I moved on to Google. But there are not too many people who have worked on growing the open source community at a national level. And what that requires is basically, dedicated team of people who can, liaise with the government, industry, academia to orchestrate the ecosystem. One is, of course, for example, if you want to grow the open source businesses in India, what you could do is you could go to the government and say, hey, you have an open source policy, a policy which says that for e-government applications, we will prefer open source as much as possible. So why are you not actually implementing it? So wherever the e-government tenders are opened, can we, have a cadre of people who are constantly monitoring these tenders and ensuring that the policy is implemented, if not fully, at least, gradually and systematically, and see the numbers of open source projects, the number of tenders being approved on open source go up over a period of time. Then we also need people who can, work with the community to see how we can scale up the community. I think one of the challenges we see, that I see at least, is that there are a bunch of very interesting open source projects that come up. They get a few grants, maybe $100,000, etc. They are able to hire 4 or 5 people and they do the development, but how do they keep it sustainable? What is the revenue model? So something like a Linux Foundation for India could look at housing some of these open source projects and build momentum. And this organization can do a lot of work in terms of helping these individual projects become more sustainable, help put them through mentorship programs where they can go out and which help them, think through business models and help them raise money. So let me just take a question from Michael. Michael is saying a lot of great open source projects got launched through universities, but they struggle to grow beyond that. Are we seeing a lot of interest in doing more regional or global outreach through programs like FOSS Asia, Google Summer of Code, Outreachy, etc.? When it comes to Google Summer of Code, I think one of the, India is probably the country where there's a lot of contribution and participation in the Google Summer of Code. When I was with Red Hat, we did a program called the Red Hat Scholarship, and we got almost 1,000 applications from all across India. And what was interesting was that the first prize winner was actually not one of the popular engineering colleges of India, but a little known college in the southern state of Kerala. I'm not familiar with FOSS Asia and Outreachy and how popular they are. It was not Devdutt, that was not Amrita. I think it was Shasta University in Cochin, if I'm not mistaken. So it was interesting to see the kind of participation that we got. And I think that's more of that kind of programs which encourage Indian students to contribute to open source would be welcome. Some of us are thinking of seeing if we can revive the Red Hat Scholarship Program, but you know, now house it in an independent entity and make it an annual kind of a program. The other thing is, why do we need a Linux Foundation like organization in India? The reason that we need something like that is, you know, for example, there were two or three of us, my colleagues and counterparts in IBM, Sun, and myself from Red Hat. The three of us were very actively involved in pushing back against Microsoft when it came to the proprietary standards. So some of you may remember that many years ago, Microsoft had proposed something called the Office Open XML as an ISO standard. And India was one of the few countries that voted against it. And then subsequently, we approved an open standards policy, which said that as far as possible, India will use only royalty-free open standards. So that policy was a huge victory, and it came only because there were a bunch of dedicated people who pushed back against Microsoft's lobbying. Qualcomm and many other companies have been, Microsoft and many other companies have been arguing for software patents in India, and the community has pushed back vigorously against it. But that's a, you know, ever-present threat in India, and unless you have dedicated people who can push back and who are constantly liaising with the government, you cannot, it's very hard to, you know, really push back. So we need some sustained effort in these areas. But I think what I'd like to do is kind of wrap up by saying that that if we work systematically over the next several years, I think we can see India becoming a huge contributor to the global open source community. I think the impact of the work that we do will also be substantial, because what we see now is that many countries are looking at India. So in India, we have built something called an India Stack, which is a stack for identity, payment, and data sharing as a horizontal platform. And as many governments across the world start looking at building public digital infrastructure in the digital sphere, governments have not really looked at providing tech rails as an open, interoperable set of rails for the industry and government and others to use. But Africa is now looking at India and saying, can we build an Africa stack on the lines of India stack? So the projects like MOSIP and mojaloop.io and others that are being built out of India might be extremely useful for other geographies. And all these have to be, you know, built on public, on open source software. So India's contribution could grow quite significantly in the next few years. The good news is that when I talk to people and see if they are interested in supporting an organization, funding it, helping us hire a few people, at least a dedicated team of two or three people for building a foundation, there is now significant amount of interest. So I think FOSS businesses have also reached a certain level of maturity where they can contribute some money and time back to the community. And this organization can work with government, academia, industry, and the community to, you know, overall grow the open source ecosystem. So let me just stop there, and I can be reached on Twitter and LinkedIn, and I try to respond as, I'm more active on Twitter than LinkedIn, but I'll try to respond as quickly as I can. So let me stop there.